Ja, herzlich willkommen zu dieser Abschlussrunde der Fachkonferenz. Wir haben ja viel in den letzten Stunden, also heute Vormittag und gestern Nachmittag darüber gehört, über die German Energiewende und wie die europäischen Nachbarn sie sehen, wie sich die europäischen Mitgliedstaaten ihren Energiemix wünschen und wie der tatsächlich ist. Und jetzt wollen wir ein bisschen darüber debattieren, wo sind wir jetzt, also was sind die Schlussfolgerungen und den Ausblick geben unter der Fragestellung 100% Erneuerbare in Europa, sind wir auf einem guten Weg, ja oder nein? Ich bin Margarete Wohlan, ich arbeite bei Deutschlandradio Kultur, bin also keine Expertin aus der Umwelt- und Energieszene, arbeite in der politischen Hauptabteilung im Thema Reportage und Hintergrund und habe etliche Radiosendungen gemacht, auch über die Energiewende, vor allem auch in Polen, über Pläne zu Atomkraftwerken und Fracking und was da so alles besprochen wird und diskutiert wird in Polen. Und freue mich auf meine vier Gäste, die mit ihrer Biografie auch ein bisschen das Europa abdecken. Denn wir wollen ja nicht über Europa reden, sondern mit den Europäern gemeinsam. Stéphane Bourgeois auf meiner linken Seite ist von der European Wind Energy Association in Brüssel, der Stimme der Windindustrie, die Windenergie weltweit promotet mit über 700 Mitgliedern aus fast 60 Ländern. Er supervised und koordiniert die Verhandlungen seines Verbandes mit europäischen Institutionen und nationalen Regierungen. Zuvor hat er im Europäischen Parlament an verschiedenen Energierichtlinien mitgearbeitet, so unter anderem an dem dritten Energieliberalisierungsakt und an der Direktive zu erneuerbaren Energien. Ganz links ist André Poschmann vom Bundesumweltministerium, seit kurzem Leiter des Referats Koordinierung und Monitoring der Energiewende. Vorher war er für die EU-Politik für erneuerbare Energien verantwortlich. Mitverhandelt, wenn ich das richtig aufgeschrieben habe, über die EU-erneuerbaren Richtlinien und deren Umsetzung und mitgegründet die Internationale Agentur für erneuerbare Energien. Herzlich willkommen. Auf meiner rechten Seite, direkt an meiner Seite, ist Martin Bursik aus der Tschechischen Republik. Er war Umweltminister dort und ist jetzt Vorsitzender der Chamber of Renewable Energy Resources, Mitglied der Grünen und seit 2012 deren Vizevorsitzender. Außerdem war er Vizepremier und saß als Abgeordneter der Grünen im tschechischen Parlament. Und last but not least, Martin Bursik war 1989 auch in der Freiheitsbewegung aktiv, die zu der Samtenen Revolution führte. Und ganz rechts von mir Anthony Frogert, unabhängiger Berater in Energiefragen und Senior Research Fellow in Chatham House, einem britischen Think Tank, das auch bekannt ist als Royal Institute of International Affairs. Mit Sitz in London. Zu seinen Mitgliedern zählen große Konzerne, Investmentbanken, Energiekonzerne und auch Entscheidungsträger aus Wirtschaft, Wissenschaft, Politik und Medien. Vorher war Mr. Frogert 15 Jahre lang, hat er Umweltschutzgruppen, akademische und öffentliche Institutionen in Europa und Asien beraten. So. Ich habe überlegt, dass man diese Frage, sind 100% erneuerbare Energien in Europa möglich und sind wir da auf einem guten Wege, vielleicht als sozusagen beantworten kann, indem man als ersten Schritt sagt, wie ist denn der Zwischenstand? Also, wo sind wir jetzt? Haben wir was daraus gelernt, aus den Erfahrungen, die wir bis heute gemacht haben? Welche Hürden lagen auf dem Weg und was ging leichter als gedacht? Und so könnten vielleicht die vier auch so ein bisschen ihre Meinung und ihren Standpunkt jetzt sagen, um dann auf die Frage zu gehen, wie machen wir weiter? Stefan? Vielleicht Sie als Erster.
Okay. So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very happy to be here in Berlin and to share views on how to get to 100% renewables 2050 or later, but at some point for Europe. So as Margarete just said, I'm going to just focus on where things stand for now. and do they look good? Certainly from a statistical point of view, they look pretty good. In terms of wind energy, we're at 7% today. This is not nothing anymore. In terms of renewables and not hydro, in terms of electricity, we're at 12% or something, even more than this. And in the last 10 years, Europe has installed more renewables than anything else and more wind than gas and than anything else. And gas was the second technology. Coal and nuclear have been deinstalled in the last 10 years. So that's pretty good. We have 2020 targets in place. They're binding. Let's see if we get there. And we also have, for 2050, a heads of state agreement to get from 80 to 95% reductions. And this agreement may not be binding, but it's a heads of state agreement, and legislation should follow on that basis. We also have a very heavy discussion on how to get to these 80 to 95%. And for the energy sector, this was mentioned this morning, it was mentioned in most panels, we have this energy roadmap that the Commission put forward a year and a half ago. And this energy roadmap is actually pretty good for us because, as you know, in all the scenarios we go, we have from between 55 and 75% of renewables in terms of energy consumption. And this is for all the scenarios, including the ones that should be or that are relying more on nuclear and CCS. And for the power sector, it goes for various, sometimes a bit weird statistics, it goes up to 100% almost for the power sector. And wind goes up to 50%, and that's very much in line with what the European Wind Energy Association thinks the sector is capable of for 2050. And this roadmap also launched, and this was pushed by the Danish presidency last year, this idea of the no regrets options. So if you want to decarbonize, if you want to get to 2050 and to get to at least 85% reduction in your energy sector, you will have to do more efficiency, more renewables, and more grids. The rest, anyone can do a bit more of the rest if they want, but this is what we have to do together as European, whatever happens. So this looks pretty good, but that's more on the statistics on what we have on the table, because the reality at the moment is a bit less exciting. We have a tough economic crisis, and the result of this crisis is that for member states, I know there was a session on this yesterday, it's a crisis for renewables in Europe and for wind in particular. Member states are doing changes to the support schemes, sometimes that are justified, but certainly very often the changes are retroactive and they're not done very well, and they're completely scaring off investors, killing the markets and killing the confidence that the sector had a few years ago. So this is a little bit worrying on one side. And then in general, what one could say is that, well, the things are going, are looking well, but this is probably the reason why there is such a backlash at the moment in Brussels and in Europe in general. There is really a feeling that renewables have grown up, that we should be in the market, that we should be starting to pay for all types of things from storage to infrastructure, that that gas is actually a much cheaper way to decarbonize, and certainly that maybe you don't need renewables targets post-2020. We have this debate now on 2030, and a lot of stakeholders, this was said by the Commission representative yesterday, a lot of the stakeholders are arguing that only a greenhouse gas target should do. If the aim is to decarbonize, why go for renewables next to this? And on top of this, we have national capacity markets being developed a little bit everywhere. This doesn't really help a corner. Certainly, from our perspective, doesn't help European integration and creating a European market in Europe, depending on how it's done. But very often, this can be done and can result in a subsidy for gas. And finally, we have general trends from the world and also very low carbon price, which mean that coal at the moment is cheaper than gas, and that coal plants are run full load all around Europe, whereas gas plants have a tendency to shut down or could be shutting down. Well, everyone knows around here that we will need them at least for a few years more to get to this 100% situation. So statistics look good, but there's a backlash and there's a lot of hurdles on the way. And I guess I'll leave the solutions or the way forward for the next question, because I'm sure I was already around 5 minutes.
Mr. Poschmann, What is about the German point of view right now?
Ja, vielen Dank. Ich glaube, grundsätzlich sind wir in einer Situation, wo jetzt gerade auch eine Weichenstellung da ist und der Weg nicht mehr so einfach wird, wie er bislang war. Die ersten 10-20% Erneuerbare waren relativ einfach zu machen. Jetzt kommen wir in eine Phase, wo wir einfach merken, dass die Erneuerbaren wirklich zu einer Veränderung führen. Sie haben wirklich einen Einfluss auf den Markt, auf den Marktpreis. Das sind einerseits sehr positive Effekte, ein senkender Börsenstrompreis, aber es ist noch ein richtiger Anpassungsdruck jetzt da. Den wollten wir immer und auch nur damit wird die Energiewende gelingen. Aber jetzt kommen eben auch mehr Probleme auf uns zu, sodass ich also das, was Stefan sagte, durchaus unterstützen würde. Die Situation ist jetzt deutlich komplexer, als sie noch vor ein paar Jahren vielleicht war. Es geht nicht nur um die Kosten, sondern es geht im Prinzip um das Gesamtsystem, Kapazitätsmarkt. Diskussion ist ja einfach nur die andere Seite der Medaille des erneuerbaren Ausbaus. Jetzt kommen halt die Fragen, was passiert eigentlich mit dem konventionellen Kraftwerkspark und wie gestaltet man da dessen Rolle in der Zukunft oder auch dessen schrittweisen Rückbau sozusagen. Der entscheidende Punkt, glaube ich, wenn man nochmal fragt, wo wir jetzt stehen, ist, dass wir eigentlich eine ganz gute Situation haben im Bereich erneuerbaren Ausbau im Strombereich. Der Progress Report der Kommission jetzt zu den ganzen nationalen Aktionsplänen und wo stehen die Mitgliedstaaten, zeigt ja relativ stark, dass im Strombereich alle eigentlich gut ausschauen. Da sieht es eigentlich gut aus. Dass aber wahrscheinlich kein Mitgliedstaat mit den Maßnahmen, die wir jetzt haben, auch sein Ziel erfüllen wird oder nur wenige Mitgliedstaaten. Was aber, wenn man genau hinguckt, hauptsächlich daran liegt, dass wir im Wärme- und Verkehrsbereich zu wenig haben. Gerade im Wärmebereich, der momentan auch total einfach zu wenig beleuchtet wird, steckt ein Riesenpotenzial und wir haben da im Prinzip kaum die Instrumente da, auf europäischer Ebene nicht, aber auch in vielen Mitgliedstaaten nicht, die wir da brauchen. Alles konzentriert sich auf den Strombereich, wo es eigentlich ganz gut läuft, wo aber jetzt auch dieser Anpassungsdruck am höchsten ist und deswegen auch der Ruf danach die Erneuerbaren ein bisschen mehr in den Zaum zu nehmen, ist ja da jetzt momentan sehr groß, muss man einfach sehen. Ich würde aber gerne den Fokus darauf lenken, dass wir vor allem in den Bereichen, wo wir nichts haben, keine Instrumente haben, auch die Performance fehlt. Also da müssen wir eigentlich auch viel, viel stärker darauf achten. Und mit dem Ausblick sehe ich das eben, ist es im Prinzip insoweit schwierig, da würde ich schon nochmal ein Fragezeichen hintermachen, hinter der Tatsache, ob wir 100% Erneuerbar auf europäischer Ebene erreichen. Wir haben im Energiekonzept in Deutschland 80% im Strombereich angezielt bis 2050 und das auch mit gutem Grund. Da kann man sich jetzt über die Höhe streiten, aber was man einfach auch sehen muss, ist, dass die letzten 10%, sage ich mal, das ist das, was es sehr, sehr teuer macht und das es sehr, sehr schwierig macht. Und unabhängig davon, wie hoch das Ambitionsniveau ist, glaube ich, was man auf jeden Fall lernt, auch von der deutschen Energiewende, ist, dass der ganze Prozess ein lernendes System ist. Dass man also auf viele neue Herausforderungen trifft, immer weiter man nach vorne geht. Und dass man da klare Investitionsziele braucht, ja. Aber auch ein gewisses Maß an Realismus bei dem Weg. Und da ist es ganz entscheidend, dass man einfach sehen muss, dass die Energiepolitiken der Mitgliedstaaten momentan sehr, sehr verschieden sind. Wir wollen alle erreichen das 80-95% CO2-Minderungsziel. Wir werden aber wahrscheinlich, viele Mitgliedstaaten werden unterschiedliche Wege dahin gehen. Das wird sich vielleicht über die Zeit konvergieren. Deswegen ist Convergence mal für mich das Wort der Stunde, was die europäische Energiepolitik betrifft. Aber es wird jetzt, glaube ich, schwierig sein, sich jetzt darauf zu einigen, wir machen 100% Erneuerbare in 2050 auf europäischer Ebene. Das entspricht einfach nicht den Realitäten mit den Energiepolitiken von Großbritannien und Frankreich. Was mir aber sehr wichtig ist, und da knüpfe ich an dem an, was Stefan sagte, dass wir wissen, wir wollen dahin, 80-95% CO2-Reduktionsminderung. Wir wissen auch, wir wollen wahrscheinlich verschiedene Wege gehen, aber es wird ein Stück weit des Weges, wird dann doch irgendwie wieder gleich sein. Also Stichwort No Regret, das ist eigentlich gerade in der jetzigen Situation, wo man nicht genau weiß, welchen Weg man gehen wird, das entscheidende Stichwort der Stunde. Und da gibt es einfach die No Regret-Optionen, Netze, Effizienz, und auch Erneuerbare. Egal, wie man es designt, egal, welche Ziele man sich setzt oder welche Instrumente, Erneuerbare werden immer in jeder Konstellation eine entscheidende Säule spielen müssen in der europäischen Energiepolitik. Und wenn das so ist, dann sollten wir die Probleme und die Herausforderungen, die sich daraus ergeben, Stichwort Kapazitätsmarkt, Stichwort Netzausbau, auch zusammen angehen und die Synergien nutzen. Deswegen wären wir sehr glücklich, wenn wir uns mit Blick auf 2030 auf den nächsten Schritt einigen könnten, ein konkretes Ziel Erneuerbarer, ohne jetzt gleich bis 2050 die Linie durchzuziehen, wegen der genannten Sorgen, sondern ein 2030-Ziel als No-Regret-Option zu vereinbaren, das wäre für uns aus meiner Sicht jetzt das Gebot der Stunde.
Anthony, ich spreche Sie gleich sofort an, weil Herr Poschmann jetzt gesagt hat, die verschiedenen Wege, die die einzelnen Mitgliedstaaten hin zu diesem Ziel gehen, sehen unterschiedlich aus. Wir haben das auch auf dieser Fachtagung gesehen, was Frankreich betrifft, was Polen betrifft. Deswegen auch an Sie die Frage, wie beurteilen Sie jetzt diesen Zwischenstand, den Ist-Zustand, in dem wir jetzt sind? Und gerade auch mit Blick auf Großbritannien vielleicht.
Maybe I can just come back to the UK, but first just touch upon some of the other energy sources, because we've heard quite a lot about renewables and the development that they've had. But I just want to reflect firstly upon coal, because it's still very important in terms of its energy supply. So it's the largest supplier of it's the largest source for electricity in the EU. So around 33%, so a third of electricity comes from coal. And there's important developments on the EU level on relating to the future use of coal. One is the Large Combustion Plant Directive, which will see closure of coal plants primarily in the UK, but also in a number of other member states. And then following on from that, you have the IED Directive, so the Industrial Emissions Directive, which affects around 60% of the EU's coal plants. So around 120 gigawatts will come under this. And this will... Either they have to be retrofitted, or they're closed, or they are limited in terms of the number of hours that they operate. And these two directives are affecting the short-term use of coal. So you mentioned the fact that you have lower coal prices, which is encouraging operation, so switching from coal to gas. But it's also quite ironic is these directives are also encouraging the use of greater use of coal. So in the UK, for example, there is a... which is affecting by the large combustion plant directive, you're seeing a rush to use up coal quickly while the going is good, while there's low carbon prices and good coal and low carbon coal prices, they're using coal more. And likewise, you're seeing more coal being used because as of 2016, you start seeing limited hours for those plants affected by the IED. You start having a limited number of hours of operation. So... It's a relatively short-term issue, but it's probably 2 or 3 years. So I just want to put that on the table because that is the reality. But I think we'll see an increased use of coal in Europe over the next 2 to 3 years. The second issue, again, has been touched upon is nuclear. So nuclear is the second largest source of electricity. So it's around 32%. So between coal and nuclear, two-thirds of the EU's electricity. They are significant players in this debate. So we mustn't overlook it. Nuclear, I think people know, is dominated by France. So now France supplies 49% of the EU's nuclear electricity. So if you take France out of the equation, it's around 15% of the EU's electricity comes from nuclear. So it's very skewed, like no other energy source, it's skewed by France. It's also quite interesting, if you take current projections of nuclear, the nuclear has been declining over time and renewables is growing, renewables overtakes nuclear as a supplier for EU energy in 2016, and it becomes the largest producer of energy. So it's an important, I think, staging post to show nuclear isn't a minority, because we will see it overtaking the largest one, nuclear. Nuclear's capacity is now the same as it was in 1986. It hasn't grown. And what this means, nobody's building new plants, but it's also meaning that you get plant life extension. And you're seeing this in a lot of countries. If the UK didn't extend the lives of its existing reactors, it would phase out before Germany. So it's a political decision to extend the life of the reactors that enables them to continue to operate. And it's an important issue because from a safety perspective, you're operating older plants for longer. And so it's an important consideration. To touch upon new build, because we've mentioned this in many ways in terms of the UK, but maybe we'll come back to that in the second session, but a number of countries are looking at building new nuclear, and it's quite an interesting in terms of the developments. It's many countries are looking for greater cooperation, so regional reactors, so you may have a Baltic reactor, you may have an agreement between Hungary and the Czech Republic. So that's a increasing trend. So trying to share the costs between different utilities in different countries, but also greater international involvement. So you see in Lithuania greater Japanese involvement. So Hitachi's looking to take a greater involvement. You're looking in Russia in terms of Finland looking to have a greater involvement, and in the UK hoping to get Chinese finance to complete the reactors. So it's not only regionalization, it's internationalization of reactor programs. Gas, you mentioned shale gas, a very important issue, not on the short term in terms of what it will deliver, but as a political opportunity to say gas is no longer a issue of security of supply, we will have our own sources. So as the domestic production decreases, again, UK and other places, they can say, well, don't worry, shale gas will replace that. So it's a political its importance is political rather than energetically, I would say, for the next decade at least. And maybe we can touch upon that. But it's important because gas becomes, or it was envisaged that gas would become the default. If nuclear phase-out occurs, we'll replace it with gas. If you don't deliver the renewables targets, gas will come in. If coal phases out because of the pollution directives, gas will replace it. It becomes the default. So it's the sort of, in theory, it's the no-regrets option. But this is where it's starting to fall apart because of the electricity markets. The problems that we're seeing, we've discussed that at length today in terms of greater fragmentation of the current markets. Too many ring fences. So we're going to ring fence nuclear, we're going to ring fence capacity payments for gas, we're going to ring fence renewables. They're not going to compete. It's the sort of fragmentation of the electricity market. And this is leading to too little investment because that's perceived as too great a risk. And so I think that's a absolutely fundamental issue. And it's starting to be seen on the outside world in terms of the impact on the utilities. So major utilities are both saying, we're not going to invest. We might go somewhere else in terms of we'll invest outside the EU, or we'll invest in another sector. So EDF or Suez will invest in water rather than electricity. So they only have a limited capital. So it really is of serious concern in terms of the investment. And so just one final point, if that's okay, just in terms of where we are now, I would say we are in a more risky situation from an energy perspective. So I've touched upon the changes within the different technologies, but just to risky in terms of if you look at technology changes. So we see the falling price of renewables. So if you're betting, you'd say, well, this will continue for a long period of time, or it will continue, things will only get better. If you look at it from a nuclear perspective, the costs are going up. So in the UK, the price for our proposed two reactors, so 3.2 gigawatts, is now around €7 billion. This is double, more than double the predicted costs when this design of reactor was first started building in Finland. So it works at around €100 a megawatt hour is what the constructors want, which is higher than most renewable feed-in tariffs. The other issues are around international markets. The uncertainty is, who knows where demand, what we're seeing at the moment is rapid demand of energy in other parts of the world, in particular Asia. So what impact is this going to have on future energy prices? We heard a lot about importing fuel this morning, about what impact that is going to have on the economy. How much is that going to increase? In theory, you have not a world recession, but we have a economic slowdown globally, but yet the price of oil is over $100 a barrel. This isn't radically changing the transport policies in different parts of the world, but we still have high prices. So I think this is important issue is what will happen on the international markets and how important is the EU in that discussion, because we aren't the major player anymore. People don't come to the EU and say, what should we do about global energy prices? They go to China or they go to India or they go to the United States. So important consideration. And the final point, just in terms of where we are, is to take note of external events. And I know Fukushima, in terms of the energy turnaround, is important, but also in terms of climate change. It tends to be external events that lead to rapid changing energy policy. And you saw that in terms of the 1970s with the oil shock. You saw it with Chernobyl in terms of what that did to nuclear policies in other parts of the world. So we need to be aware that although we may make these good plans and provisions, it is often external events that change the sector.
Vielen, vielen Dank für diesen Beitrag. Was klar geworden ist, es ist ein sehr komplexes Problem und es ist auch eine sehr komplexe Analyse, die wir hier versuchen, sozusagen aus dem Ärmel zu schütteln. Und was auch klar wird, ist, dass es ganz viel mit Unsicherheit zu tun hat und mit Ereignissen, die von außen kommen. Und plötzlich müssen wir mit neuen Situationen, mit neuen Realitäten klarkommen. Martin, Sie sind in der Tschechischen Republik sehr unterwegs, auch für die Erneuerbaren. Ist es so ein komplexes Problem oder könnten wir da nicht vielleicht viel weiter sein?
Hello, great honor to be here and thank you for the invitation. And I will do the same trick as what Anthony did. So I will not answer your question at the very beginning, only by the end of otherwise I will not have the opportunity to describe my evaluation, where we are. And if I jump immediately into the Czech Republic situation, it will be definitely completely depressive for you. And I don't want to deliver this message out of Prague to you. Anthony was starting his, or finishing his... extremely interesting presentation with the word planning. And I was just thinking about, we are asked to talk about the year 2050. I mean, in my age, to speak about that year, it's quite easy. It's I know that the average length of life is getting longer and that the health service is better and better. And so, I mean, you know, if God allows me, I will be 91 that year. And then we will be, with most of you here, we will be evaluating. what we've said. Look where we are. Let's say that we started serious effort for promoting renewables, energy efficiency, and cutting the greenhouse gas emissions by 85-90% by 2050. In the year 2007, if I may say. That was under Sarkozy presidency, the French presidency, and the climate energy package that year. So it's 6 years ago. And we have another six years until 2050. So there's only 1/7 of the way to 2050 beyond us. And I think this is very good timing of this conference because these first-year binding targets, member states implemented the different feed-in tariffs, quota system, green certificates, whatever. We were on a track. Then the statistics. I mean, if you want to see a really good graphics of the statistics, go to the EVIA webpage. I go there. They do it perfectly because they're happy about the development of wind, of course. And so all this is okay. But I think that we all feel, and also the atmosphere here around yesterday and today, is that we are starting to be a little bit nervous. And the reason, I mean, it's my of that feeling is that I think that the big industry, the nukes people and the coal people, started to be nervous as well. Because I think that the harm... The level or the depth of the influence of this change up into them is even bigger than they have expected. They said at the beginning, okay, so we will leave a part of our market to renewables, but still we can continue to do our business. Okay, but look, suddenly appeared a merit order effect, and the spot price of the electricity is on 42 euros per megawatt hour, and who can build a conventional power plant under these circumstances? And suddenly, and that's again reflection to the statistics, suddenly it's only renewables. In the last year, let's be exact, 47% of the investment of the installed capacity in Europe, photovoltaics, 22% gas, 21% wind. And if you look on last 10 years, so it's the winner is a gas, 116 gigawatts in gas, 84 wind, 47 photovoltaics. So it seems that it's renewables because of these direct support schemes different types, and then gas. Mainly because of gas is able, it's very flexible with respect to the construction time, and it offers the electricity in a peak time when the prices are so attractive that the gas can live out of these peak prices, and that's it. And even now the gas is having a problem. So it's evident that there is an urgent need. If you look on the problem out of the eyes, imagine that you are in a coal business or in a nuclear business or even a gas business and try to look to the problem out of their eyes, suddenly you have an urgent need to change. To change this situation, otherwise they are out of a game. And I think that the first step is this trial where a testing country is Britain, because it's an island state. They decided to leave coal, so there is a urgent need of a new installed capacities, and then the new member states. Czech Republic, Poland, Hungary, because the attitude of the public there towards nuclear is rather positive compared to the average in the EU. The sociologists should answer us why is it so, but highly probably because there hasn't been any critical debate about nuclear ever, because the anti-nuclear movement here in Germany, which built the grassroots for the Green Party, at that time there were no debate about nuclear. When there was the accident in Chernobyl, we were having no information about that. There was no debate in the Czech Republic as well as in Poland and other countries about Chernobyl. So there was no opportunity for serious debate about nuclear. And suddenly there is this sort of competition. So I think that the nukes people identified these countries, which out of their or in their understanding, are the weakest, where the probability of getting the public in favor of this promotion of nuclear is the highest. And so I think that, and then when we speak about 100% renewables by 2050, theoretically, imagine that in Britain, after several years of a negotiation with the Commission and a state aid issue, let's say that the Commission approves the contract for difference in Britain. Then, Anthony, what, 10 years, at least 10 years of construction of the power plant, it could be 14 years, whatever. So, okay, so we are by the year 2015 plus 10 in 25. So we are somewhere between the year 2025 to 2030, when theoretically, the new nuclear in Hinkley Point, Somerset, will be connected to the grid. And then we have another 40 to 50 time operation time. So it's 240 plus 40, either 50, and we are far over 2050. And we can forget 100% renewables in Europe. So I think that this is, that the fight is about this, and that we will have the opportunity to speak also about what to do, how to avoid this in the future. But what I want to say, it's very long. It's very difficult to predict what's going to happen. The people who are experts in education, they say that within 40 years, we do not know 60% of the types of the employment activities of our children. We cannot even imagine what our children after 40 years, what kind of work will they be doing? And according to experts, 60% of that types of work we cannot imagine. We don't know. So it's really very hard to evaluate this. But on the other hand, the life cycle of these huge installments is so long that the decision which is gonna to be made these years, it will influence the situation in the year 2050. Thank you very much.
One or two sentences about Czech Republic, please.
Okay, I tried. I tried. It's if you want one sentence, so then I tell you there is a tough competition in our country, and the very powerful state, dominantly state-owned electric utility CEZ, has been misusing its context to the politics, illegal financing of the political parties, and they are having a power to set up the rules in favor of them, and their favor is to keep the status quo. So it's a big fight of them not to allow the newcomers, the small decentralized sources of energy like renewables, to enter the market, because they know that they will lose their position on the market as well as political influence. To be very, to deliver you a very actual information, which most of the Czech citizens do not know already, there is a proposal, an amendment of a renewable support act in our country, which wants to cut any operational subsidy for renewables since 1st of January next year. So there will be no support scheme, no feed-in tariffs, no premiums, nothing for new installations. The new act wants to, or the amendment, not even that. They want to retroactively hit the existing operators of renewables who are having 20 years guarantee of a feed-in tariff or premium. In the case of small hydro, it's even 30 years. They want to set up the rule which will give an obligation to the operator to provide the economics of the certain project after 10 years of operation to the state. And if it shows that that the investment has been paid back already, there will be no further subsidy after 10 years. So this is retroactive. This will be a disaster for all the loans which these investors were taking in the banks, because the loans were for a longer period of 12 to 14 years. And last but not least, part of this law is a contract for difference principle. That means green bonus or feed-in tariff for nuclear. So this is the actual situation in the Czech Republic. Thank you for asking.
Could I just add a thing on the UK? Just Martin introduced it very well in terms of the nuclear debate, but I maybe just add a few bits around it, because it is an important test case. So what the government is, for a number of years now, been putting through or discussing the sort of the reform of its electricity market in the same way that other countries are. And one of the key aspects for this was to move away from a sort of requirement on a percentage of renewables within the electricity sector to having a form of feed-in tariff. So what's called a contract for difference. And why it's different from a feed-in tariff is that the government, they set a what they call the strike price. So what they think the price of electricity will be for a fixed period of time. So in the case of renewables, this is a 20-year. In the case of nuclear, it's for 40 years. So they are saying, we anticipate that the price of electricity over the next 40 years will be, and what is said in the press, it will be around £100 a megawatt hour, so around €100.
€118 what EDF has been asking.
Well, we'll soon be pounds for euros. We'll exchange soon. But anyway, so it's around this. And so what they're saying is, if the price of electricity is below this, then EDF gets, or the operator gets that made up. If it goes above it, then they have to give back to the electricity producers. So it's absolutely fundamental what that strike price negotiated is. So in the case of all the other renewables, there is a group of companies who wish to build, and they together negotiate, and they may even auction it and say who has the lowest price. But in the case of nuclear, in theory, there was three companies that were going to build nuclear. There was NewGen, who have gone quiet and are not likely to build. There was Horizon, that was EDF RWE, that pulled out and have now sold it to Hitachi. And then there was EDF. And so the other two aren't going ahead. EDF is still proceeding. It had a British partner called Centrica, who have now pulled out and said it's too expensive. So EDF is left solely negotiating with the government. So there is it's behind the scenes. So we won't know what the strike price is, or actually how long the contracts for difference will be, but it is reported to be around 40 years and for £100 a megawatt hour. So if the current market price remains the same, so in the UK it's around £50 a megawatt hour, EDF will be making around £1 billion a year, additional money over the price that it will get for the electricity. So that's over a 40-year period is quite sizable amount of money that comes from consumers towards the company. But I think what's particularly important is, as you pointed out, is the length of time. So you won't see regression, as you see in other places, where you see the feed-in tariff reducing every 6 months or a year as the technology improves. This is a lump sum fixed for a considerable period of time. And it was mentioned that the state aid ruling. So it has always been a question, how will this be justified under the EU the state aid rules? And as we've heard, they're changing them, so it's no longer environmental state aid, it's environmental and energy. So in the draft that is out for consultation, and I would urge people who think this is important to submit your comments, you have till the end of this month, it has two paragraphs that mention nuclear, and it talks about how it will be transformed from a renewable environmental state aid exemption to a low-carbon one. And this, in the UK context, it's very important. The government has set, for the next through until 2020, the amount of money that it allows, effectively allows the feed-in tariffs to charge consumers. It's a cap. And this process will be taken forward. So they will cap the total amount of additional subsidies or support schemes that renewables, CCS and nuclear, will be able to take from the consumers. And so if nuclear goes ahead, then by default it means that the others will have less. And so there is a straight relationship between investing in nuclear and renewables within the UK.
Wie Sie bemerken, sind wir sozusagen am Shiften von sozusagen dem Ist-Zustand und dem, was tatsächlich jetzt momentan da ist und dem, was in den nächsten Jahrzehnten auch passieren soll oder welche Schwierigkeiten und welche Probleme und welche Trends es gibt, wenn wir an dieses Ziel denken, 2050 tatsächlich 100% erneuerbare Energien oder in naher Zukunft 100% erneuerbare Energien zu erreichen. Aber ich nehme von Martin mit, dass wir einerseits nicht so nervös sein sollen. Also wir haben erst 5 Jahre hinter uns oder 6. Von daher haben wir noch einiges vor uns. Und gleichzeitig ist aber der Ausblick in Tschechien, aber auch in Großbritannien, was die Erneuerbaren betrifft, nicht wirklich Optimismus prägen oder optimistisch. Gut, ich würde jetzt aber trotzdem noch mal so ein bisschen halt auch wirklich auf dieses Ziel die Diskussion hier unter uns Vieren öffnen. Welche Instrumente, welche Methoden sind notwendig, um weiterzukommen, schneller weiterzukommen auf diesem Weg der Erneuerbaren? Und wir haben heute Vormittag, aber auch gestern Nachmittag einiges gehört über die verschiedenen nationalen Sichten und die Unterschiede innerhalb der 27 EU-Mitgliedstaaten. Und ich will Ihnen am Anfang ganz kurz eine Geschichte erzählen. Ich habe vor ungefähr einem Jahr ein Interview geführt mit Waldemar Pawlak. Das war damals der Vizepremier in Polen. Und der Anlass war, dass Polen damals laut geäußert hat, dass sie 2 Atomkraftwerke bauen werden in Polen. Und in Deutschland war der Aufruhr sehr groß, die Sorge auch darum, weil eins sollte in der Nähe der deutsch-polnischen Grenze gebaut werden. Und ich habe Herrn Pawlak gefragt, ob er denn die Sorgen der Deutschen verstünde. Und er hat mir geantwortet, also erstmal möchte er darauf hinweisen, dass die Deutschen im Gegensatz zu den Polen reichlich in der Vergangenheit von der Atomkraft profitiert hätten. Und wir nehmen zwar die Sorgen der Deutschen ernst, aber wir beobachten auch, dass die Deutschen solche Sorgen bei den französischen Atomkraftwerken nicht haben und auch bei den Plänen der Russen in der Nähe von Kaliningrad ein Atomkraftwerk zu bauen nicht haben. Deshalb möchte ich doch bitte darauf hinweisen, wir mischen uns nicht ein in euren Ausstieg aus der Atomkraft, also mischt ihr euch nicht ein in unsere Pläne und unsere nationale Energieversorgung und auch der Wille, unabhängig von Russland zu werden. Weswegen ich das so erzähle, ich würde gerne die Frage hier an die an meine 4 Gäste setzen, ist diese Haltung, ich gehe nicht auf den Inhalt dieser Aussage, sondern wirklich die Wahrnehmung von Herrn Pawlak auf die EU und auf die anderen Mitgliedstaaten, ist diese Haltung typisch für andere Mitgliedstaaten und ist sie ein Problem, wenn man daran denkt, dass man ja einen Kompromiss machen muss, dass man sozusagen die anderen ins Boot holen will, um wirklich auf dem Weg 100% erneuerbare Energien voranzukommen. Herr Poschmann, in dem Beispiel war ja Deutschland Counterpart, der von Herrn Pawlak sozusagen kritisiert wurde. Was sagen Sie dazu?
Yeah, first of all, I would prefer to switch to English as well, because I have a tendency to talk too fast in German to be translated properly. And I think from the European perspective, it would be better to be polite to my guests as well. I think the main argument again, or the main argument in this context is, I think one has to accept that member states for the moment follow different energy policies. We have in the new Lisbon Treaty explicitly the right to decide on the national energy mix and to exploit its energy resources granted to every member state, and this is for good reason. Even though if you wished that everyone goes the way we go and follows the way, I think it's for the moment it would be unrealistic to force others to do exactly the same. That's why, as I said before, I think it's very important to accept that for the moment every member state might want to have the flexibility to follow different pathways, but to agree on no regrets. I'm happy to say this again, because I think that's the word of the hour, so no regret. What is the no regrets? And renewables are clearly a part of it. And irrespective, or being closer to your question, I think it is fair to say that that we don't want to be forced by other member states or by the EU to make a fallback with respect to the energy vendor. So we don't want to be forced to stop renewables. At the same time, we have to accept that others want to rely on nuclear for a certain period. I think there's a question then of security and whether we are affected by it, okay. But in principle, I think we are not in a position to say, to forbid others to try to follow other pathways. But what we should agree on is on the no-regret pathways and the investment signals, which are in any case right. As I said, we cannot know exactly which technology might be the leading one. What we know, maybe, is that we need a diversified approach. Several technologies, several sites cannot rely only on one technology, one way. That's why it's important, in my view, to agree on a renewable target for a certain amount, because it's clear from all what we know, all scenarios, irrespectively of what member states decide on which concrete pathway they want to follow, renewables will be a significant part of it. And as it is, if you're based on this, you have to find a way to follow and to find synergies in doing it together then. Because the implications we caused through our energy window, they are there. You cannot deny them. But you need to solve them in the internal market context. So grids will be needed, and the whole electricity sector will be more depending on fluctuation in electricity in the future. This is a matter of fact, I think. And that's why it's important to try to follow then this pathway together for a certain amount and with synergies. But where I'm concerned about is two things. The one is, as I said, we are not in a position, or it is fair to say, we don't want to force, let's say, France to do the nuclear phase out that we did. But on the contrary, we don't want to be forced either to stop renewables. And unfortunately, at the moment, the discussion we see on the European level is exactly heading for this. So, for instance, the Royal report, MDEB Royal, who did a report on the energy strategy, renewable strategy, he was very much in favor of arguing for harmonization and for cutting tariffs for renewables, or to go to a scheme where we only, or there are others who argue we should only go for a scheme driven by the ETS on CO2 target only, or by a harmonized scheme. And this would mean that we are in Germany not longer in a position to follow our pathway of the energy vendor, to build up renewables, but then we would be in a position that we could not decide on our energy mix anymore. I mean, one has to see in this context that we cannot when we want to achieve 80% renewables in 2050, we cannot rely only on imports. We will not import 80% of electricity from North Africa. This will not be possible. So to a certain amount, we need to rely on exploiting our resources and renewables. That's why it's so important to go for a diversified approach, which leaves enough flexibility also for us to do this energy wende further and to agree on a common framework, to agree on the no-grid target, and to agree on a framework which is in line with the internal market, yes. We should go for convergence, we should go for more alignment of the question how to support renewables. There are certain elements which will be more and more needed. One is cost reduction, the other is market integration. But the question if and to what extent we want to rely on renewables and therefore support renewables, this should not be taken away from us. That would be the counter-argument as well, which one needs to take into consideration when arguing in this whole context of harmonization and so on. And I think here again, it is very important what Martin also said. We are now in a situation where we pushing the existing conventional power plants out of the bed. The renewables causing a real change. And what we see is a lot of arguments trying to avoid this or to stop this or at least to slow down this. One is to say, no one invests anymore in coal and gas and nuclear, so give us support for this, which will mean we lock in the old conventional power plant and we cannot change the system as we needed to. We cannot go into this renewables and flexibility system. So this is one argument to say, give us subsidies as well. If you subsidize renewables, give us subsidies as well for the other technologies. Irrespectively of whether there is no chance to reduce the technology cost, nevertheless, they want to get subsidies for this. And this is, in my view, very counterproductive for our pathway because it will lead to a lock-in effect into the existing system and avoid exactly the change we wanted to achieve. The second thing is they say, okay, then let's try to go only for a CO2 alone target and a CO2 only target and ETS away only, which would mean in the end that particularly smaller or medium-sized companies could not enter into the market because the price signals of the ETS is fluctuating very much. It's not only the electricity price risk, it's on top of that the certificate price risk. So you have a double risk. And this will push out small and medium-sized companies out of the market, new actors. So this would be a way to somehow lock in into the old system and avoid new competitors, which is not on top of this, not only our position either. So, and the second argument would be if we could not achieve subsidies for conventional power plants and if we could not achieve ETS only, then let's at least go for harmonization where we only support renewables, let's say, in North Africa or in big offshore plants, but not in a decentralized or diversified approach, also taking into account medium-sized installations. And this is, at the moment, the situation we face, that we have a lot of a big majority arguing against the pathway we follow in Germany and arguing for a way which allows to survive, let's say, more, and which to avoid the pressure to change. And this is something which we think in a European context is very important to realize, that it is very that is necessary in order to achieve, maybe in a long way, a European energy mix which relies more on renewables. It is necessary that countries who at the moment wants to go for this pathway are allowed to do this, and show that it works. At the moment, we're in Germany, we face a lot of challenges, okay, and also problems, yes. But the good thing about it is that half of the country is discussing it, thinking of new technologies, thinking of new ways and solutions to solve this, to sort this out. This whole capacity market discussion is a big challenge, but also a big chance to come up with a completely new flexible system, new solutions which we don't know yet. Which might that be? The minister always says we need an iPad of the energy wende. So something which we don't know yet, that it might be invented in 2 or 3 years, but will change anything, everything. And this is something we need. There's a good situation at the moment in Germany. And if we are able to solve this, bringing down further the prices, as we saw in the PV sector, and coming up with new solutions of flexibilizing the whole system, then the energy wende might be will be a success, and then others will follow the pathway. But if we are not allowed to do this further, and if we try, let's say, to go for a system where we support renewables only at areas where they do not cause any pressure, let's say in North Africa, then we will never get others on board to follow the same pathway. So my main message would be leave the flexibility for member states who wants to do this to show and to prove the test case, and agree on no regret options and on certain steps which in any case are right for everyone, and agree on that, for instance, a next step target maybe, and use the synergies which might be deprived from that.
Martin möchte gleich was sagen, nur kurz nachgefragt. Das heißt, Sie setzen auf das Beispiel Vorbild. Wir zeigen den anderen, dass es geht, und die werden schon mitkommen. Habe ich das richtig verstanden?
Yes, I think at the moment it's the only way I can imagine to allow different approaches for different member states, but to try to agree on certain steps which we do need to go together, but agreeing on them is no regret, so to say. But above that, leave enough flexibility to go different pathways, because otherwise this will end up in a situation where we agree on a European level that the German energy wende is nonsense.
Aber auf der anderen Seite erlauben wir damit, wenn wir so ein bisschen nachgiebig sind, sage ich jetzt mal provokativ, wenn die anderen Mitgliedstaaten halt dann eher doch auf die Atomkraft setzen und das weiter ausbauen, weil das natürlich auch mit dem Ziel, diese 2 Grad zu erreichen, sozusagen harmoniert.
I agree, but at the moment I don't see the political majority or I don't see a possibility in Europe to agree on all of in all member states that nuclear is a bad thing. This is just reality. What we might achieve is that renewables play a significant role in all member states, irrespectively of whether they also follow nuclear and other technologies. They all will need renewables. So we don't know whether nuclear will be a solution in the future. Germany thinks it will not, but we cannot at the moment pursue everyone else in Europe. It is a matter of fact. So try to agree on that renewables are a significant role, try to go this pathway together, try to go for a 2030 target. But at the moment, we cannot force others to do a nuclear phase-out. This would be, in my view, unrealistic. We should try to convince them that it is a pathway which is the future. But therefore, we need a test case.
Martin.
Yes, I think, thank you very much. I think we cannot force the others, but we can at least, on the platform of Heinrich Böll Stiftung, speak openly about that. And I think that, I mean, from my point of view, this is a sort of misunderstanding. I understand well that you are a representative of a ministry here, and so it's a sensitive issue if we are asked to comment a statement of a Polish ex-vice minister, even though he is ex, so still he is. It's my case as well. And but the question is, do you think that this ex-vice minister was representing the interests of the state more, or was he more representing the interests of a coal mining industry and the energy industry? And this is a very important difference. And I mean, if I'm organizing a conference about 2050, I would put 2 questions. And one question would be, where will be the influence of the energy utilities by the year 2050 compared to small decentralized producers of the energy? And the second question would be, we probably will touch it, shall we get rid of a perverse subsidies, and shall the renewables be on a market, on a real market? But I mean, I do have experience with Poland during our presidency. It was a little bit more than half a year before Copenhagen. There was a Czech presidency, and we were adopting as the environment ministers the resolution on climate. The Polish minister hasn't arrived. And the people who were there on behalf of Poland, they were having no mandate to approve it. But we need a unanimous vote of the ministers there. So we were then forcing them to call the prime minister so that we get the position of the prime minister. And the 26 environment ministers were quite anxious about that situation. So this is nothing against Poland. We have, I realized with Andrzej that we have so many similarities, but probably the most important similarity, and it's different in Germany, it's different in Britain than in these post-communist countries, is the power of the energy guys, their influence on the legislation, on the legislation, their influence on the politics. In my country, the Czech Energy Works, they are having majority within the government. They're having the majority within first chamber of the parliament, as well as the second chamber of the parliament, as well as the president. And so it's really, really very tough and difficult to change. But this sort of argumentation, the energy mix, it's up to member countries. We will do it on our own. You will not interfere into our interests. I think that the way how to get over this obstacle, otherwise there will be two Europes again. There will be two speeds in Europe. And the Czech Republic and the others will stop renewables and promote nuclear and forget and promote even coal and forget the commitments on renewables and climate. By the time they will be not binding. It's very important to push through the binding targets. Or this will be somehow described open and gradually with the help of transfer of the experience out of the countries like Germany and others, there will become a sort of emancipation of the society where the people will be asking a change within the national governments, and then it gradually comes. And I completely believe that 2050 we will really be, it will be really very different. But I don't want like these politicians who are trying to explain that it's the interests of the country and of a people, and it's in fact nothing else than the interests of this of the business. Thank you.
Es gibt hier gleich zwei Meldungen. Ich möchte dazu noch hinzufügen, ich bin drauf gekommen, als ich jetzt dir, Martin, zugehört habe, vielleicht ist es ja auch eine Idee, Projekte irgendwie zu initiieren, Windenergie, Solar, Biogas, die an den Regierungen vorbei Verbündete führen, also wirklich regionale Projekte. Ich weiß, dass in Ostpolen Bauern in Gemeinden selbst sozusagen gucken, ob sie Biogaswerke irgendwie finanzieren können und mit der Unterstützung von europäischen Umweltschutzverbänden. Wäre das eine Idee, wenn ich höre, dass hier durchaus Regierungen, gerade in osteuropäischen Staaten, auch wirklich Interessen von sozusagen fossilen Energien oder eben Nuklearpower vertreten. Wäre das eine Möglichkeit, die Erneuerbaren ein bisschen weiter voranzutreiben, Stefan?
Certainly. I actually wanted to jump in on what Martin was saying, because I would tend to agree, because I brought with me, but there's a consequence to this. I brought with me the latest Eurobarometer. This is the poll that the European Union does quite often in all member states. And this one is about attitudes of Europeans towards air quality. And the question is, thinking about the next 30 years, which of the following energy options do you think should be prioritized now in your country, in this country, so in all member states? 70% of Europeans think that renewables should be promoted. So the answers can be renewables, efficiency, nuclear, CCS, shale gas, or unconventional fossil fuels, or just conventional fossil fuels. And the respondents can take two answers. So it's 70% for the whole of Europe. This is the average. But for Eastern Europe, where people have a tendency to think that there is less support for renewables, renewables come still first in all of the new 10 member states, and they're all above 50% in all these member states, apart from Romania and Bulgaria, where it's 45 and 48%. So I think there is really a role there for civil society, and I'm sure there's a lot of representatives of civil society in this room. In these countries where it's true, civil societies are not very well organized, the lobbies and the pro-renewables forces are not very well organized, but certainly there's a role for us in Western Europe and for civil societies in Western Europe to help the debate move forward in these countries and to use these polls, because I'm sure it's not the only one. I mean, we've had Eurobarometers talking about the popularity of renewables for all Europeans for the last 10 years, and it's always the first technologies that come out. We've had this for so long, so certainly there's a big role to play there, so that the government's position is not only a utility position, and so that the governments, when they go and negotiate and talk in Brussels, they're also responding to what their people think and not to what just the interest thinks. So the interest of the big utilities. So I think this can help us in the debate, because the next point I want to make is really more about the European debate and what we can do in Brussels and in the European institutions. And I think, I agree very much with André in terms of using as much as possible these no regrets options and the Energy Roadmap 2050 as a principle. Because what is interesting in the roadmap is that this roadmap has a lot of assumptions, and the main assumption is, of course, all scenarios need to meet this 85% reduction in greenhouse gases by 2050. And the other assumptions are you need to have security of supply in terms of system security. You need to have some some cost parallelism, and all the scenarios have very similar costs. But what is interesting is that the cost assumptions of this roadmap for renewables are very, very conservative. For wind energy, basically there's zero value curve, so the costs don't come down in any of the scenarios. For PV, it's even more shocking. But despite this, renewables come first. So what I want to say here is that if you did the same thing today, you would probably get an even better result in terms of costs, in terms of the overall going for more renewables. Going for more renewables in Europe. But I think on top of this, what is interesting is that this roadmap does not, because it can't, or certainly it's not really possible, it does not look into the macroeconomic benefits of going for more renewables. And I think this is a very important point that should be made in the debate. Also in Germany, because I know there's a debate at the moment on offshore and the costs of offshore, and I think very often this debate only looks a bit like McKinsey consultancy at the cost efficiency of getting to 2030 with the different technologies, but doesn't look at the benefits in terms of local jobs, in terms of manufacturing industry. And certainly, yes, offshore is more expensive than onshore wind, but on the long term, offshore costs will come down more quickly if we go for offshore more quickly. And in general, in the long term, we'll be in a better place if we have developed a broad range of technologies and not just one or two. So I think this macroeconomic is an argument in favor of renewables. And on top of this, what the roadmap does not look at all is energy independence. So energy security in terms of reducing our dependence to imports. The energy roadmap says that the different scenarios have different results, but it doesn't model this in. But certainly, if you would model energy independence in a scenario, well, in the direction that we all want to do in Europe, you would need to factor in a little bit of being less dependent on imports. Well, if you do this, once again, you get to a system with many more renewables. So I think we really have all the arguments on our side. But as I was saying, as everyone is saying, there's a big backlash and a big debate, and there's a big Baustelle. There are a lot of things we need to work on at the moment. The first one has been talked about by André, is 2030. It's key, and I hope that Germany will be a bit more aggressive in the coming discussions. There's already an informal summit with the two ministries involved in 2 weeks, and the problem in Brussels is that very often the German voice is the voice of two ministries which say different things, so I'm looking forward to hearing one German voice in favor of renewables at that meeting. And I'm also looking forward in hearing that Merkel will have blocked a move for a greenhouse gas-only target in the discussions in Brussels, because if a greenhouse gas-only target goes through in Europe, this is completely against the German interest and even the big business. So my members too, I have Ian and all these guys, of course, they also now know that Germany needs to go renewable. So it's in Germany's interest to go down that path. So we need to get these 2030 targets in, maybe not now. We need to maybe play with time, delay the discussions a little bit. We need to go and talk to the French. We're now discussing about how to get to 50% nuclear in the coming 10 years. How do the French get there without doing more renewables? I don't know. So certainly there's a role to go and try and bring in the French towards some support of more renewables. It's not easy, but it's doable. And I think we can eventually get there to get a 2030 package which goes for more renewables, maybe not 50-60% in 2030, but leading us to a path which can bring us in the long term to 100%. The other big Baustelle is the state aid debate. It's been mentioned quite a lot already today, so I'm not sure I've got much to add, but it's very, very important. And it's very important that everyone, yes, responds to this consultation. For us, Wind Energy Association, this whole debate is a little bit shocking because we've been asked for the past 5 years to come off support schemes, and permanently this story on support schemes for renewables is about renewables should go in the market so that the costs come down, and when the costs come down, the support should go down. But now nuclear is applying for a contract for difference for 40 years, not 20 years, not 15 years, 40 years, and the cost of nuclear have always gone up. Everyone knows it in this room, and the cost of nuclear will continue to go up. So if you give a support mechanism to nuclear the way you want to give it to renewables, eventually you're completely going in a different direction than a direction of developing technologies and bringing them to maturity. Nuclear is mature. It's expensive, but it's mature, so it shouldn't get the same type of support as the one we did. So that's a very, very important step, and maybe, well, there's the whole capacity mechanisms discussion, which maybe I shouldn't get into, but these two points are important. Yeah, one last point, which I'm not sure has been mentioned today, the ETS and putting a price on carbon. So this is, surprisingly, nobody mentioned this today, but putting a price on carbon is quite relevant when you want to make coal more expensive than gas, for instance, and others, and when you want renewables to be more able to compete. The carbon price is at 5 euros today. Once again in this debate, Germany has no position. So with Germany having no position, next week in the European Parliament, the German MEPs from the German parties, in particular to the right, will vote in all directions. We have no idea what will happen in that vote and backloading. And in the Council, things are not moving because there's no German position. And if there was a German position, you would have things moving in the Council, and this would certainly send the right message to the Parliament. And this is also key because we need a carbon price. Maybe it's not the ETS. If backloading is rejected next week, maybe what we'll need is another type of system, but we need a type of system which puts a price on carbon in Europe, and I think we can get an agreement on this in Europe.
Herr Poschmann, Sie müssen jetzt darauf antworten.
I agree completely with everything, and if I had a wish list, everything what you mentioned would be on top of it. But the problem is the reality. I fully agree that all the arguments are in favor of renewables and all the arguments are in favor of ETS. We need investment signals, long-term avoid lock-in effects. I can show you all the speeches and what we prepare every day on this. And also agree that the people, they want to go for renewables and for clean technology and climate. Everything is clear, and it was the same situation in up to the Copenhagen Agreement. And in fact, we ended up with no Copenhagen Agreement. And at the moment, we have, unfortunately, the same situation in Europe and also partly in Germany. As I said, we decided to go this pathway as with concrete intermediate target until 2050, but it causes now pressure. And the guys who are affected by the pressure try to defend their position, as you said, Martin. And I fully agree with you in all what you said, but the conclusion is not rather clear to me. My conclusion would be, at the moment, or one step back, I fully agree with Stefan as well, that also the economic arguments are completely clear. The roadmap showed evidently that renewables will be a very big part of it. And on top of that, it showed that the high renewable scenario, we have had a high share of renewables, is not more expensive on the way to 2050 than the other scenarios. Because due to the technology degression we see there and due to the grids development and the investments would have needed anyway in the conventional power plant, if you calculate all these opportunity costs into the whole basket, then renewables are not more expensive than the other pathways. And on top of that, the technology assumption, the cost assumption, were old cost assumptions. PV was calculated with the cost we saw 2 years ago, before we had this dynamic cost regression, which was in Germany cut by more than a half. And we missed renewables and efficiency combined scenario. We in Germany, in the energy concept, we decided to combine renewables and efficiency because then it becomes really, really cheap. And this was missed. So if you base this calculation of the energy roadmap on the current costs of renewables and combining it with efficiency, it is even cheaper. Okay, so having said that, okay, all my arguments are there. Everything is there. Everyone should agree. And no one agrees. Because exactly what you said, the industry is lobbying heavily against this change because they have invested over years in the wrong technology. Funnily enough, in the course of the energy vendor, there was an article in a newspaper showing that back then in the 1970s in Germany, when the government decided to rely on nuclear, all the energy companies were arguing in the same way as they now arguing against renewables, against nuclear. Meaning that the main argument is not which is the economic sensitive way forward, but, oh, damn, I have invested over the last years in the wrong technologies. How can I get out of it? And that's why we have this capacity market discussion. There's one argument. And asking for the extension of lifetime and everything, because they do not want to accept, well, it's difficult to accept, to write all these investments off. But this is the reality, and that's why they are lobbying very hard for better conditions for them, which could either be giving me subsidies or stopping this renewables nonsense. And at the moment, sorry, it's not my position, of course, but at the moment in Europe, we see very, very many member states, majority of member states, who is following this position. And against this background, we have one or two, or let's say five member states who are following the same path as we do. As Stefan pointed out, not even Germany is always clear in its position. So at the moment, we don't have the same situation as we had back in 2007, where Merkel was, where we had a presidency, where we had a commissioner who was concluding the discussion in the Energy Council, where everyone jumped on the table, particularly UK and France. We don't want a renewables target, concluding as, yes, I heard a lot of support for my position for renewables targets. We will discuss further. We don't have the situation at the moment in Europe. And against this background, it's very important to agree on what is agreeable. And agreeable at the moment in this very difficult situation is a 2030 targets, perhaps, and it will be difficult enough to get this. But a 100% renewables target in 2050 is completely out of discussion at the moment. And that is the argument I was trying for. Try to agree on what is possible, and this is the no regret, and try to avoid, and that is the second argument, try to avoid that we follow into an instrument discussion, which prevents Germany from following this route, because this is the second thing which is being played at the moment. Not only the discussion on targets, but the discussion on instruments, where we at the moment see in the state aid provisions, in the revision of the state aid framework, and also in the discussion on the 2030 climate, a tendency to say all low carbon needs to be treated equally, meaning we are not anymore allowed to justify against state aid or in the context of ETS to follow a renewables support pathway. So this is the moment, this is the situation what we are facing at the moment, and I would be very happy if we achieve at the end of it a 2030 target and the green light for pursuing the energy vendor. More at the moment is very difficult to achieve.
Ich würde gerne noch mal ganz kurz Anthony dazu Stellung nehmen lassen, weil sie sich gemeldet hat. Und dann würde ich gerne sozusagen die Diskussion ein bisschen öffnen, weil ich gesehen habe, da gibt es einige Wortmeldungen, auf die wir dann eingehen können.
Very briefly, just to add, because I know people want to say something. Two things. One on capacity payments and markets. I think it's important to consider it is one option about balancing grids. And I think there's four options on the table. There's one is interconnections. There's two is capacity payments. Three is electricity storage, macro and small and large. And the fourth is smart technologies. And I think it would be wrong for us to assume that the capacity payments is the only way forward. And this is, unfortunately, the tendency. That's linked into the utilities. I would argue that they're not seeing that they've vested in the wrong technology, they see the writing on the wall in terms of their the institution of utilities themselves are going to diminish, and potentially, as Martin said, it will disappear. And so it's really a question of how do you move into the space that the utilities currently hold. And so you're starting to see this. And again, I give a UK example. There was a renewable energy firm, one of the first utilities that was established just to sell renewable energy to consumers. And the rise of the feed-in tariff means that they've changed their model from one where they invest in new renewable facilities to one in which they now coordinate people's rooftop solar. And so the way they described it is we now have 10,000 producers in which we now coordinate. And I think that is the model that you would assume would be going forward, that you move from consumers to producers to this prosumers, I think, is what they're now calling it in the UK. And it made me think there was a green term or the Green Party. It was not left, not right, but forward. And so is there something along this which is it's not public, not state, but community? It's something in which you move to a different direction, a new model that says actually it's a different way of thinking. So anyway.
Also jetzt gibt's die Möglichkeit, sich zu melden. Wenn nicht, können wir natürlich hier mit einigen Fragen weitermachen. Die Dame hier vorne mit dem grünen Hemd, sie war die erste, und dann der Herr da vorne.
In English or?
Wie Sie möchten. Ist nicht an?
Oh, yeah. Entschuldigung. Eva Quistorp, ehemalige Europaabgeordnete der Grünen, die das Vergnügen hatte, die Erneuerbaren zu versuchen, um auf einen Schlag um 40% zu erhöhen. Ich bin aber 1989 im Forschungsrahmenbericht. Ich bin aber überhaupt nicht mehr so eine Expertin drin, wie Sie jetzt oder die aktuellen Grünen oder die junge Generation, die jetzt hier ist. Ich habe also überlegt, an welchen Stellen ich noch was aus meiner politischen Erfahrung einbringen kann und wo ich Lücken sehe. Also das eine ist, dass teilweise hier so diskutiert wird, was auch muss, weil wir müssen eine Experten- und eine Fachdebatte führen. Aber das Problem ist doch auch, dass wir die Energiewende, und zwar nicht nur in der Bundesrepublik, sondern europaweit wenigstens flankiert, zu einem Zeitpunkt versuchen, wo es gleichzeitig die Finanzkrise und gleichzeitig die Debatte um die sogenannte Staatsschuldenkrise gibt. Ich rede lieber erstmal über die Finanzkrise. Aber hier geht es ja auch um Kredite und es geht auch darum, wie macht man die Energiewende sozialverträglich. Und ich habe es eigentlich in meinem politischen Leben nie für, Zerstreutheit von mir gefunden oder dass ich mich nicht spezialisieren könnte, sondern ich habe immer eine Kombination von spezialisiert sein, Fachkenntnisse im Energie- oder Nahrungsmittelbereich oder Frauenrechtsbereich und gleichzeitig gucken, wenn wir in der schwächeren Position sind, wie es ja nun doch weltweit und sogar auch europaweit ist und wir sozusagen eine Verteidigungsposition erstmal des Erreichten sichern müssen, wie Sie sagen, Herr Poschmann, und nicht nur maximalistisch, so nach dem Motto, wir schreiten jetzt in die Solarzukunft gemeinsam voran, sondern wir müssen gegenüber der Lobbyarbeit der alten großen Energiekonzerne und deren total geschickter Lobbymedienarbeit müssen wir auch so etwas wie eine Strategie haben, erreichte Positionen zu sichern und dann mittelfristige und so weiter Strategien darauf aufbauen. Müssen wir, glaube ich, politisch auch diskutieren, hat sich die Situation verändert für uns, für unsere Fragestellung durch die Finanzkrise und wie können wir gezielt, gerade mit der Debatte über Spaltung von Nord- und Südeuropa und Austeritätsprogramme in Südeuropa, wie können wir gezielter das Angebot der erneuerbaren Energie als ein Angebot an Jobs, als ein Angebot an Zukunftssicherheit, als ein Angebot, wie Sie sagen, an das Kommunale, an das Gemeinwohl sozusagen verstärkt, nicht nur jetzt im Sinne parteiprogrammmäßig, sondern möglichst relativ praktisch im Sinne von regionalen Märkten debattieren und dafür Strukturen schaffen. Das ist eine. Das andere ist, ich im Forschungsrahmenprogramm, ich habe hier wenig gehört, wie denn die europäischen oder die nationalen Forschungsprogramme und wie die Universitätskooperation oder Ingenieursschulen oder ich weiß nicht, was ihr jetzt alle machen müsst, Bachelor oder so. Also wie gezielt ein Teil der Budgets und der Forschungspolitik in den einzelnen Ländern, aber bei uns ist es ja auch föderal, und EU-Forschungsprogramme, wo da Lücken sind, wo wir da bessere Lobbyarbeit machen können und wo wir da für die Interessen der Erneuerbaren gezielter Universitätskooperation, Ingenieursschulausbildung und sowas einfügen können. Und das dritte klingt sehr schwach, also nach sehr Soft Power, aber die ist ja manchmal auch nötig. Diese Europäische Bürgerinitiative, die Grünen und auch andere verkaufen die ja als das ganz tolle Ding. Ich bin da nicht so euphorisch, weil ich weiß, wie schwierig es ist, eine europaweite Öffentlichkeit zu organisieren. Aber es gibt jetzt eine Europäische Bürgerinitiative bezogen auf Wasserprivatisierung. Warum nicht eine Europäische Bürgerinitiative von dem Netzwerk, was hier ist, als eine europaweite Bürgerinitiative organisieren, die, wie Sie beide argumentiert haben, darauf besteht, dass Atomenergie und Erneuerbare nicht auf derselben Ebene behandelt werden, was Support angeht, sondern dass da eine ganze andere Kostenrechnung aufgemacht wird und dass auch die Demokratierechnung aufgemacht wird. Und ich explodiere an dem Punkt, wenn ich höre, dass zum Beispiel die Kosten der Atommülllagerung anscheinend in der Debatte über Förderung von Erneuerbaren und Förderung von Atom nicht in der Debatte ist. Und ich will zwar hier von der notwendigen Rahmenbegrenzung des Themas nicht ablenken, aber die Kosten der Atommülllagerung, was das an Forschungskosten, an sozialen Kosten, an ökonomischen Kosten bringt, finde ich, müssen wir politisch in die Debatte angebliche Vergleichbarkeit der Atomenergie und der Erneuerbaren dringend reinbringen.
Ich würde gerne noch ein, zwei Meldungen sammeln, wenn Sie sich Stichworte hier machen, um sozusagen dann auch den Herren hier die Möglichkeit zu geben, auf einzelne Punkte einzugehen. Okay.
Rolf Wüstenhagen, University of St. Gallen, Switzerland. Many of you, and especially Martin and Anthony, alluded to the lobbying of the existing sort of incumbents. But I think, isn't there a fine line between lobbying as in the legitimate defense of interest and some of the examples that both of you mentioned from the UK or from the Czech Republic, where it sort of moves from legitimate to maybe illegitimate or maybe even illegal? I mean, some of the examples you mentioned in terms of payments by the incumbent to some politicians are beyond sort of just the legitimate defense of interests. And is that perhaps an angle that could be pursued by someone, and who would that someone be, to really look into where this line is crossed and where some of the incumbents are pursuing illegal practices? And could that perhaps be a solution to some of these problems?
Dieser Herr war zuerst, und dann würde ich kurz einen Cut machen und sozusagen kurz die Antworten abrufen und dann können Sie wieder weiter, ja?
Okay, my name is Christian Bonneur. This is a question for Anthony. I would like to know or to get information about the current situation of the support in the UK for PV, wind energy onshore and offshore.
Okay, das war kurz. Vielleicht vor Ihnen war... Sie waren eigentlich der Erste. Nee. Sie waren nicht der Erste. Sorry.
So, Skúli Sigurdsson, Max Planck Institute for History of Science. I have two questions. One to Anthony and specifically to Anthony, namely, what happens to the... What is this grid which one is speaking? Being spoken about, because if the utilities in some sense may be changing as an entity, what isn't it also, if one takes the smart grid message strongly back home, doesn't it also mean that the grid is historically and sociologically and conceptually evolving? And therefore I would like to make it pointed, one has heard about these utilities and their sort of corrupt or rather sleek practices in the Czech Republic. But I know from Germany, that you also have Netzbetreiber, and so you don't only have utilities, but you also have those corporations that run the grid. And somehow we only have heard about the utilities so far, but I think in a way that seems to be the grid operators also need to be mentioned as an entity in the discussion. I mean, and not only about Kraftwerkspark and the producers. And the other sort of question to the whole panel is, but it's spurred by Martin's excellent comments about these guys from these utilities in the Czech Republic. What is the gender dimension to this whole debate? We have guys, and there are four guys on the panel. I'm a guy speaking here. But there is a gender dimension to the history of technology and to energy politics, because very often it was the utilities and the men who produced and the women at home who consumed. So women consume, men produce. So there is a domestic gender dimension to this debate, which I think would be fitting at the Heinrich Böll Institute or Stiftung to have some commentary on the gendered dimension of this debate, if only one thinks that. I mean, so I think there is, that's a crucial issue, is gender, and not only to have it as a masculine guy is a fair.
Okay, das geht aber ziemlich in die Breite. Ich würde jetzt ganz kurz einen Cut machen und auf die gestellten Fragen hier im Plenum einfach mal die Herren nacheinander bitten. Anthony als Erster, oder?
In terms of the UK and the renewables, I mean, they have different mechanisms and different support schemes for different types of renewables. So they have, for the smaller ones, they have feed-in tariffs, and then they have renewable obligations on the utilities, in which they are required to increase the share of renewables within the electricity that they provide. But as I mentioned, they're in the process of changing this to move the system towards more of these contracts for difference, so that you will have different prices charged for different technologies. So, I mean, I guess in summary, there isn't a single system across all technologies. Each technology has a different scheme depending on the type of electricity that's delivered, but we can talk about it more directly if you want afterwards. The question of the grids, I think, is really important. I think it's you would hope that you have ultimately you have utilities that are much more separated from the grids, and that the grids are technology neutral and neutral from suppliers and consumers. And in some ways, the liberalisation packages that we've seen from the EU over the last 20 years, this has been the intention. But maybe what we're seeing is that technology is actually the bigger driver, is that you have all of these political intentions, but potentially development of micro-generation will force this liberalisation in a way forward. And so I guess it's important that the grid operators, I think, probably are given more responsibility in terms of balancing issues and strategic issues rather than just managing the wires. And I think that may be a way in which we can help increase security of supply. And I'll leave it there.
Thank you for the questions. I will answer several of them. To these Eva Christoph questions, I think that the issue of more jobs, I mean, we do know the analysis which compare a number of jobs in the fossil fuel industry compared to renewable industry. We know that the results are dominantly in favor of renewables. So, I mean, there are arguments in favor. The question is how much these arguments hit a certain individual by the time it's not connected to the individual case of a person who's seeking the job, like 80% of a university graduates is in Spain, or others who are stressed by the crisis. So it's the more it hits certain people locally, I think the stronger the argument is, in my feeling. And that's also a reaction to the very good point which Anthony said. It's we should maybe the existing model change for the model of the way of a production and consumption on place, so that we promote much more local production and local consumption involving the local people and municipalities and individuals. In the society like the one of mine or other Central Eastern European countries, it's a slight problem, because these 40 years of communism damaged the social relations, the way the people communicate, the people are prepared to cooperate, and so by the time I hear here in Berlin that 80% of the new cooperatives which are settled up in Germany deal with energy, it's a dream for us, because in our country the people are having a problem to somehow to cooperate on a much less important and less difficult issues than to agree on a setting up some individual municipal system of energy supply and to cooperate on it. So I think that the way forward, not way out, but way forward is really to support the renewables in a local decentralized form where the people will be involved. I think that we need the economic projects, the mechanisms which will be offered to the individuals as well as to the municipalities, where this will offer them the jobs, but this will offer them also a clean electricity, this will offer them independency. And I think that this model will arrive in a rather short time, that a photovoltaic will be able to deliver individuals a model which say, okay, you can cut half of your costs of the electricity because you will cover it by your own production. And then there's just 50% rest where you should identify the solution. And then as far as grids and distribution, I think I got one theory. I think that the energy, we know about unbundling, we know that the operators of the distribution companies formerly were isolated, divided out of the mother electric utility, theoretically, in my eyes. And I think that the strategy of the industry is that by the time they are receiving lower income out of selling the electricity on the market, they are compensating this by increasing the regulated price of a distribution in those countries where the regulator is weak and is not able to control the costs of the distribution. This is definitely the case of our country, of my country. So thanks for the cost of a distribution in our country is 53% of the consumer price of the electricity. It's incredible. And it's totally untransparent. You don't know where the money goes. No public tenders, nothing like this. It's completely unclear. And then we speak about 8% price increase due to renewables. And okay, I will leave other questions to the others. Thank you very much.
Stefan, vielleicht auch noch mal kurz die Frage unterstrichen von der Dame mit dem grünen Pullover, ob es sowas geben sollte wie grenzüberschreitende Bürgerinitiativen oder Projekte jenseits der nationalen Regierungen der EU-Mitgliedstaaten.
Yeah, when I got the Eurobarometer out and I talked about initiatives, that's exactly the type of thing I was thinking about. I wouldn't be able to tell you exactly what should be in the initiative. I'm not sure what you're suggesting, choosing between renewables and nuclear, should get the same support exactly. I'm not sure this should be it. Probably I'm thinking more a citizens' initiative pro-renewables, on renewables, on a full renewable society, something like this. This will definitely help the debate, I think. And also because of the timing, the state aid issue, I think it's worth reminding that this is happening now and finishing at the end of the year. So it's quite urgent, and a citizens' initiative would need longer time. But yeah, it's typically a very important thing that should be made and should be used. As for your question on the finance, well, more comment on the finance crisis and using the growth argument, I completely agree. We tried to make the point, I mean, for the wind industry, we have a very good story. We have a wonderful report, which is called Green Growth, that came out last year. There's a lot of great stuff in there, including the fact that between 2007 and 2010, the industry increased jobs by 33% when the jobs were decreasing by 9% in Europe. Everything in that report is wonderful. But to get that report to the heads of state, who are the ones who are discussing austerity and starting to discuss growth, is the question. So I'm not sure. I don't really have a strategy as to how to get there, but certainly, yes, there is a case to be made for green growth and for a green recovery out of the crisis, and that will help us and will help us on this way to 100% renewables. But I'm not sure I have the strategy here, but maybe let's discuss it in the coming month. As for research, we could have talked about research. I didn't talk about it because it's a little bit of a depressing topic in Brussels. The history of research, well, I can tell you not just for Europe, there's a CEM, so it's the Clean Energy Mechanism. It's a big agreement between members, between a lot of states, mostly European, but also US, Japan, etc. The investments in research for nuclear in the last 10 years, so 2000 to 2010, was $56 billion for nuclear, $22 billion for fossil fuels, and $16 billion for renewables. This is the whole investments. This is including the EU budget. So 16 for all the 12 technologies, comparing with 56 for one, maybe two technology, if you count fission fusion, if it comes after 2070. And for the EU budget, it's very similar. You had $12 billion out of the EU budget that went to nuclear until today, from FP1 in the 80s to today. And wind got $350 million. So $350 million against $12 billion. That's the reality of the funding for renewables versus nuclear in Europe. And unfortunately, this will continue because Europe has Euratom, which is a treaty which is about funding a lot of things for nuclear, including research. So they have a budget line. They will always get a budget. And they're even, I think, I'm not sure about this, but I think they're out of the big deal. Renewables get a little bit of the rest of the cake, but the rest of the cake is almost only half of what nuclear gets. And we have to fight now for gas because gas is saying that we need new research, inflexibility, etc. I have someone in my team who works 100% of the day on research. We work on this, we communicate on this, but it's such a difficult topic. And the reality in Europe, the nice thing is for wind certainly, we're at the stage today because we have targets. For 2020, we have binding targets, and this is what has spurred innovation and investments in research in the private sector. And that's the good thing that we have in Europe. We have targets and we have a direction, so companies know that investing in research, despite the fact that there's not much public research, there will be a market for this innovation. So let's continue with targets and let's continue to fight for research, but it's a difficult one, unfortunately, in terms of funding. On UK support, you answered everything, but I just like this thing because there's another nice statistic. UK Committee on Climate Change looked at energy prices in the UK, and the history between 2006 and 2010, or maybe 2004 and 2010, the increase for energy prices has been huge in the UK. I can't remember how many pounds, maybe 300, 400 pounds per household. Out of this increase, 70% or 60% is due to gas. The support for renewables is only 6% of this increase. And a quite similar comparison can be made in Germany, but I won't go there. On grids, you've said everything. There's a lot to say about grids. It's key, but I won't go there. I don't really know what to say about gender, so I won't answer on that one. And I saw Mark wanted to comment. I was thinking that you might ask, so I'll just say it, that everyone always says that member states have a right to decide on their energy mix, but there is a little bit of a contradiction in the Lisbon Treaty, because it is true that the Lisbon Treaty also says that European energy policy should promote renewables, should aim at promoting renewables. So there's a bit of a contradiction. So the energy mix is only part of the story in terms of legal terms at EU level.
Schmann, vielleicht auch noch mal Ihre Sicht auf die Finanzkrise und die Einsparungen der Regierungen.
Yep. I've noted several points as well. I'm just trying to link my comment to this, the one Stefan said, the last comment. I think there's no contradiction at all in the treaty, because again, it is underlined there that member states might go for different pathways, but that renewables must be a piece of a basket in any member state. So again, no regret is also reflected in the Lisbon Treaty. I'm happy about that. Also, this is also one thing I'm rather happy about, because when we talk about Euratom, I think this is a little bit balanced by the Lisbon Treaty, because there's only renewables and efficiency in there. Okay, it says new and renewables, but leaving this aside, renewables and efficiency are specifically mentioned as policy goals of the Lisbon Treaty. No other technology. So that's a plus. Regarding the cost shares, I fully agree that at the moment there is no level playing field. We invest more and we support more in other technologies still. But as you said as well, and I would like to underline this, the targets is the discussion to overcome this. CO2 target is the one who helps us including the external costs. And the renewables targets helps us to shift support. And without renewables targets, it will be much more difficult to justify in the state aid context renewable support. So again, I would underline this. As regards the comment that we are in Europe in a position of fighting to get this what we achieved or only, I think we are. I would like to put it a little bit more positive. It's not only a fight to keep the way we achieved. It's a little bit more a slowdown, or a little bit more the next step is a little bit more difficult than the first one was. It's a balanced approach. Of course, we are not going backwards. We are going forwards, but not to the maximum position maybe at the moment, but to a little bit more balanced step, hopefully. So there is a CO2 target discussion. Hopefully we will sustain this. And there's a renewables target discussion. I hope that we will get the renewables targets as well. But the maximum position, that's difficult at the moment. Convergence is the thing I think I would like to stress, to strive for. Convergence is possible, and we should go for that. Regarding the financial crisis, and particularly, you said something on that, the green job influence, yes, I fully agree, but the question was a little bit, what about the North-South conflict there? And Germany always being very much criticized for its rather tough position in the financial crisis, I think I would like to see our government much more putting in favor what we did for paying for technology development. So we paid, at the moment, all of us pay 18 billions or 70 billions per year for support costs for renewables. And this is something, when I'm in some European workshops or something, I can tell you this one to explain completely what I mean. I was having a beer with a Swedish guy and a British guy, and we discussed, and they said, and the Swedish guy said, the Germans paid PV for the whole world. That was a really heroic approach. And the British guy said, yes, we should forgive them everything. So what I try to say is that that I think this energy vendor and the investments we already did and we still will do are investments for Europe economy, not only for the German economy. We are importing also wind miles from other countries. We are importing PV, okay, at the moment mainly from the Chinese, but this is part of the game. This was the same as we saw in the TV sector and in a computer sector. This will be always like that. We are inventing something. We are trying to push the progress, but the mass production will not be in Europe. Okay, that's part of the game. But the system competence and how everything works together, the storage, the electric vehicles and everything, this is still something which we can do in Europe, and there are the job dynamics, not only in the PV panels. So I think this is a huge, in my view, the Renewable Source Act in Germany is a huge tender for all European countries, all European undertakings which are invited to take part of this. And particularly with respect to the South, I think Greece is an example. We 2 weeks ago, our state secretary signed a contract with Greece where we try to help them pushing the right framework for renewables in Greece. And our main message, or the minister also said it at the ARENA conference, look, yes, Germany paid a lot, but what is the consequence of that? You can have it cheaper if you start now, and you can learn from our mistakes. We have made experiences, yes, but we have also made mistakes, and you can avoid this. So we were, let's say, the front runner, and you can avoid the early mover mistakes. We have early mover advantages, but there were also early mover experience, and others can profit from that. So I think what we did here is somehow very much supporting economic growth also in South, and I would like to see this much more underlined in the discussion. As regards community and local level, I think I would try to differentiate a community vote on more renewables. Yeah, it would be the right time now, because as Stefan said, this is the year where we discuss everything. We have the state aid framework, we have the 2030 discussion, so everything is on the table now, and a strong vote in favor of renewables is much welcomed. The question of whether we should go much more for local renewables, I think the question here, the answer here is we need a balanced approach. I think it's difficult to say it's good if we only go for decentralized solution, because that's simply not the truth. The energy system will work in an internal market. Also, local solutions need to be connected to the grid and balanced in the European internal market. So the mix is important, not only centralized at some sites, but diversified approach all over Europe, also consisting of some local initiatives. If they are cross-border, all the better. But I think it's difficult to come up only with local and community solutions without a proper framework. So in order to give you the opportunity to come up with community projects, you need a proper framework. Otherwise, it will be difficult, because you will need some sort of support for the time being. And we would like to give you the support, but therefore we need the overall European green light to do so. So only community level is difficult. I think it is one argument and one player. But nevertheless, we need to look that we have the right framework. Lobbying, I would like to say something which I think no one likes to hear now here in this context, but nevertheless, for a balanced message, I would also like to say that, yes, it is a problem. I also agree that we have at the moment a lot of companies lobbying for surviving in this area, but always, as always, the I would like to say also that the lobbying issue is also an issue. In on the contrary, we had we tried, for instance, in several novels to reduce the costs in our Renewable Source Act, because of the dynamic technology regression, and because cost for the public is very important for the acceptance. You cannot only point the finger to the others; you also have to make sure that we have no over support, because otherwise you will get the public acceptance problem. And as we tried this, we learned that also the renewables companies became growing up and lobbying very good to avoid things. So it's always an issue, not only at the one side. I fully agree, but I would like to have a more balanced message here. And the gender dimension, yeah, it's very difficult for me as well. What I saw is that if you only look to renewables, the word women is not in there. But if you add no regret and climate, then you have the word women in this three.
Ich lasse es so stehen, Herr Forschmann. Ich habe kurz noch mal eine Frage zu der Finanzmarktkrise und der Schuldenkrise, weil es mir ein bisschen zu schnell wegging. Das führt ja, diese Krise ist in Europa ein total großes Thema, und es führt auch dazu, dass sich bestimmte politische Allianzen in einzelnen Mitgliedstaaten ändern. Letztes Mal jetzt Italien, Februar 2013, wo auch diese Anti-Established-Partei von Beppe Grillo hochkam, die nicht bekannt ist für grüne Politik und für Erneuerbare und so weiter und so fort. Kann uns das auch ein bisschen um die Ohren fliegen? Dass sozusagen noch verstärkter oder verstärkt gegen die Erneuerbaren vorgegangen wird innerhalb von der Europäischen Union?
I think it's always important to see which governments are the changes of government. So I think in France we saw now with a new government much more open position with the announcement of reducing the share of nuclear, without explicitly saying that it means raising the share of renewables, but nevertheless it's welcomed. One other argument is Netherlands, who were very strict against any renewables target, and now with a new government are much more open to discuss this. Elections are always important.
Okay. Ich würde jetzt eine kleine, kurze, zweite Runde mit Fragen öffnen. Also Sie waren schon dran und es war eine Dame. Genau, wenn Sie sich dahinter stellen würden, so vier Leute, die könnten wir noch schaffen.
Thank you. Mark Johnston again, brief point. I think the Greens have got rather sleepy and complacent in their old age, the Greens in Germany. I'll say why. André mentioned energy mix and the treatment of nuclear and a strategy towards nuclear. It was correct to say that the in-principle decision to allow a new nuclear plant to be built or not is exclusively for each member state. But Europe does control the subsidies, and therefore even though, of course, new nuclear is not contemplated in Germany, as we've heard over the course of the conference, it is contemplated elsewhere. The UK is a test case, but there could be, you know, based on the outcome of that, there could be new units in the Czech Republic and Poland. Günther Oettinger, as Energy Commissioner, has a direct say in the determination of that question between now and the end of the year. So if the Greens want to not only phase out nuclear in Germany, but see a steady phase out of nuclear in Europe, including in its neighbouring states, pressure on Oettinger between now and the end of the year, alongside his colleague, Vice President Almunia from Spain, who deals with competition issues, will be decisive. Money is the most decisive issue about whether new nuclear goes ahead or not in Europe and whether subsidies are allowed. Without subsidies, it's very unlikely to happen. So whilst the Brits consented to new reactors last month, true, but construction has not begun yet until the money is sorted out. And Germany in particular, given the politics of nuclear in Germany and given that the Energy Commissioner is from this country, can still have a decisive influence on nuclear elsewhere in Europe. And I would urge everyone here that has some influence on that to use that opportunity this year. Thanks.
Ann-Kathrin Rabe from Heritage School of Governance. My question refers to the ETS, which was shortly mentioned in the debate. And the ETS has now entered its third phase this year, and some important reforms have been undertaken. And how far do you think that the ETS can serve as a promising European technology neutral market mechanism to increase investment in renewable technology in the future and maybe a little Europeanize the German energy turnaround? The emission trading scheme, the Zertifikatehandel.
Sorry, nein, dieser Herr war schon bei der ersten Runde und ist nicht reingekommen. Aber wenn Sie ihn vorlassen, sozusagen, yeah, go ahead.
This is sort of nothing. My name is José Donoso. I am from the Spanish Photovoltaic Association and I am a lobbyist. I am a lobbyist in favor of renewable energies. I think that to do lobbies is nothing but. It's normal in off economical sector, in off economical activity. We wanted to convince the regulator, especially in regulator sectors, that our ideas, our sector is good for the society, it's good for the economy, and worth the support that they needed. But there are burdens between the lobby that we do and the lobby that do others. I can put one example, very illustrative, I think, in relation to our situation in Spain. In Spain, in the board of our utilities, we can count two former prime ministers, and at minimum, I remember now, from memory, eight former ministers. This is lobby. This is fair lobby. To be in a board of a utility is nothing. It's to receive a lot of money for not to do nothing. I think we need to put burden to this not unfair lobby. In Spain, we have another very successful sector of the economy. In the textile sector, everybody knows, I imagine here, Zara, or Zara, how you pronounce. But in the board of Zara, they don't need any former prime minister or any former minister. Why do they have it? And in some cases, it's not people that have more power or more relation with the government in now, but it's a message that they pass to the minister of today. They say, if you are a good guy, tomorrow you can have this candy, this prize. And then I think the lobby is good, it's necessary for our economy, but we need to put burdens to this lobby. And it's not the same lobby that do EWEA, that do UNEF, and that do others. Thank you.
Wenn ich die beiden Herrschaften noch mal kurz bitten würde, wenn ja, sie auch... Ja. Bitte?
Haben wir noch so viel Zeit? Okay.
Wenn Sie sich kurz und knapp halten, ja.
Okay. Ja, mein Name ist Konrad Kunze, Büro für die demokratische Energiewende. I want to make one positive point, because we have so much pessimism today. Referring to what Mr. Forget said, we are depending very much on outside events, which we can't influence very much. and one of these events is peak oil, and we all know peak oil is probably past us. And there's all this optimism negative optimism about shale gas and fracking, and there's probably no way of stopping the gas and oil nations like Britain, Holland, Norway, of putting all their money and all their hope into shale gas. And the positive news, in my opinion, is that there's an increasing number of reports. The last one was from the Energy Watch Group just 1 week ago, that this whole shale gas hype in the United States is probably going to turn out as a big bubble, just like another dot-com bubble. And the good thing could be that we just lean back, wait for 2 or 3 years, and then the Dutch and the British are just going to figure out they've invested billions into shale gas and it's a bubble, and peak gas and peak oil is just going to happen in this decade with fracking or without fracking. So this might be another positive event, an outside event, as you mentioned. So that's one point for optimism.
Mein Name ist Albert Reinhardt von Politikschule Internet im Agenda 21-Prozess. Ich wollte nur kurz aufmerksam machen, dass wir halt eigentlich eine Kulturwende auch brauchen, um diese Energiewende hinzukriegen. Also von unserem kapitalistischen Verständnis, die Einzelinteressen gelten und stehen in Konkurrenz zu jedem anderen, müssen wir einfach zu Haltungen kommen, die kooperativ und kooperationsfähig sind. Und da dürfen wir auf gar keinen Fall, das will ich nur sozusagen noch mit auf den Weg geben, die Jugend außer Acht lassen. Entschuldigung, ich dachte, ich bin jetzt gemeint. Es gibt halt in der Pubertät bestimmte Phasen, wo die Umwelteinflüsse sozusagen als zweite Natur verinnerlicht werden. Und wenn wir Jugendliche nicht ermöglichen, sozusagen an diesem Konzept der Energiewende mitzuarbeiten, aktiv, schaffen wir es nie, dieses Bewusstsein bei denen auch herzustellen und als Haltung zu etablieren. Also wir rennen eigentlich irgendwas hinterher, was wir nicht schaffen. Also es ist technisch nicht lösbar, wenn es sozusagen nicht kulturell unterlegt ist. Danke.
Entschuldigung, ich muss das jetzt wirklich kurz mal stoppen, weil es gab noch andere, die sich beteiligen wollten, und wir sind wirklich sozusagen an der Deadline. Ich würde gerne auch dem Mann, Ihnen sozusagen, ich würde gerne zu Ihrem Thema sagen, Bewusstseinswandeln und sozusagen kulturelles Verständnis und kulturelle Veränderungen. Das ist natürlich ein ganz großes Thema, weil es geht nicht da sozusagen um Mobilität und nicht nur sozusagen um vielleicht weniger Energienutzung und um andere Lebensweisen, sondern da kommt ja viel mehr dazu, diese Share Economy, die jetzt aufkommt und so, vielleicht nicht mehr so viel besitzen, sondern auch teilen und sich ausleihen und wieder zurückgeben. Dafür könnten wir vielleicht eine neue Fachkonferenz initiieren.
Yeah. Okay, so let's go to the answers. I think that this is going to be a final word because we are close to the final. I mean, to react on a lobbyism on this issue, I hope I wouldn't like any kind of misunderstanding that I am anyhow critical towards an open, transparent lobbyism. That's legitimate, and we know that out of the United States that there is a tradition of dozens of years how it works, but it's difficult to have a more balanced view on lobbyism, as you said, if you live in a different country than Germany. I remember when I asked my colleague Sigmar Gabriel, how is it, Sigmar, that you got such a support for renewable policy within your country, and he said it's easy. That time it was, I think, like more than 200,000 employment places in renewable. Just you need that support. We had a wonderful debate that the Swedish minister was there. He said, I got a support of a king. I got even more than you. But so if it is unbalanced within the country and the power of renewable and energy efficiency sector is rather low and of the NGOs, then it's logical that you are very, very sensitive towards this kind of lobbyism. Capacity payment, I should say, I might can correct my position towards this, but I consider this as a big risk. My feeling is that the nuclear
industry wants to hide beyond renewables. They want to create the conditions which formally are open for all kinds of zero carbon technologies, and that then they will launch the tender for 2,000 installed capacity. That will be one tender, and the other tender will be for 10 megawatts installed capacity. The first will be dedicated for nuclear, and the second one might be for wind. But they will be able to set up the conditions where that will not be the competition of price because of setting up. So I'm quite, I have a fear out of this principle that it is the way how to get nuclear back on stage. And the last question, emission trading scheme. I had the opportunity to advocate this system, the old system, the grandfathering system in the United States, in front of the congressmen who were in favor of carbon tax more than a cap and trade, and that was before Obama's administration was trying to push through the cap and trade. I am an advocate of ETS, and though the price of carbon is so low and it's not functioning, there were many, many, many mistakes. One of the major ones, too high national allocations plans and too many allowances on the market. But look at the backloading. The problem is that the issue is so complicated to be translated to the general public that the people simply do not know about the fact that next week the parliament will be discussing backloading. And they even don't know about the fact, I suppose, where's the position of the Germans is. Backloading. Means what? That's the problem. That's what Václav Havel described, the PTIDEPE. You know what it is? It's a language of the bureaucrats. It's the language we do not understand. And the problem of this is that it's so complicated that you cannot deliver it to the public and get the support. If the people know that the parliament decides about withdrawing a certain amount of allowances, which will cause increase of the price of carbon, which we want, because then it's fair, it's internalizing of externalities, another petit epée, and then we would support it. But the problem is that it's so complicated, and a backloading problem. We don't have time to get in it. We don't have time to go in it. But I can, on this certain issue, I can show you how the interests of a certain businesses influence the position of the state, and the result will be highly probably nothing. And that means that the emission trading scheme would not be effective because of the fact that we are not, as a general public, and we are not able to translate the interests of the industry into the language which is understandable to the public, so that the public can understand it and support a certain position of the government towards this issue. And that's, I mean, I do not have the answer to this question, but I find this as a very it's probably a long term task for the politicians and those politicians who deal with these issues and who want to be open and transparent and pushing the modernization, to be able to translate this and then find the support of the public. Thank you very much.
Ich bedanke mich bei den. Die Zeit ist vorbei. Ich hätte auch noch gerne ein paar Fragen. Jetzt war der letzte Beitrag ein bisschen pessimistisch sozusagen. Also wir brauchen einen langen Atem zumindest, um weiterzugehen. Aber dazwischen waren ja auch sehr viele Lichtblicke. Ich bedanke mich bei Ihnen. Tschüss.